the Lord. Amen. How's everybody doing this? I almost said this evening. This morning. Amen. Let's all stand. It's so great to be in the house of the Lord. Amen. Let's give the Lord a good hand clap of praise in Jesus' name. Praise God. Amen. Let's lift up our voice and magnify Him.
Praise the Lord. Let's all worship Him this morning. Thank you, Jesus.
Show us Felt the hand of heaven reach down through the deeps and
Shout, no, I'm shouting from my heart.
trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. And all will sing. How great. How great is our God. How great.
Then sings my
Praise God. We want Brother Lukky to come at this time. I've asked him to speak this morning. And I'm so thankful that the Lord is raising up local ministers within this church body. Amen. So thank God for Lukky. And then we've got Hector and Ben. And then TJ, licensed minister. And then Timothy. So we got five. Amen. So God's building what I guess sports teams would call a deep bench. Amen. Championship teams have a deep bench. If the star player gets hurt, they got somebody else to come in and back up. So, amen. Lukky, we appreciate you. We thank God for you and for your ministry. We want you to come and preach the word of the Lord. Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's praise him. Hallelujah. We serve a great and mighty God. Hallelujah. There is none like him. Come on, let's worship him. Let's praise him. Hallelujah. He's worthy of our praise. There's nobody like our God. Come on. Hallelujah. God is worthy. Hallelujah. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, church. Let's press a little bit harder. Hallelujah. God, we thank you. God, we praise you. Hallelujah. 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 Oh, glory. Hallelujah. Jesus' name. Hallelujah. God is awesome. Thank God for church. I thank God I could come here on a Sunday morning and get a refreshing, get a renewing in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. There's nothing like living for God. There's nothing like serving God. You can look for this whole world and find nothing like him. You can look through every bar, go to any bar, go to any place, and you will find nothing like our God. Our God is a deliverer. Our God is a savior. Hallelujah. There is nobody, hallelujah, that compares to our God. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. There is only one Lord. Hallelujah. Jesus' name. If you would turn with me this morning to Luke chapter 4, we'll read 18 to 21. When you're there, say amen. Starting at verse 18, it says, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to preach deliverance to the captives, and recovering of the sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised, to preach the acceptable year of the Lord." And he closed the book, and he gave it again to the minister, and sat down. And his eyes of all of them that were in the synagogue were fastened on him. And he began to say unto them, "This day is this scripture fulfilled in your ears." I'm going to preach this simple thought this morning to the gospel of Jesus Christ. God, we love you. God, we thank you, Lord. God, you are awesome. God, you are faithful. You are wonderful, God. And Jesus, there is none like you, God. And I just pray and ask, God, that you would bless this service, God. I ask that you would take me out, God. And Jesus, Lord, that you would speak through me, Lord, God. That you would increase, oh, God, and I would decrease, God. I'm asking and praying for your anointing. I'm praying, God, your hand on each and every one in this service, God. I pray, God, that you would help me to minister. God, help me to speak clearly, God, in Jesus' name, Lord. And I just pray the power of the Holy Ghost would move in this place, God, like you've already have, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you all. You may be seated. The gospel. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. We know that this is Jesus speaking because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal those that are brokenhearted. Is there any brokenhearted here this morning? Is there anybody that's brokenhearted? Is there anybody that's poor this morning? Is there anybody that's struggling this morning? Is there anybody going through it this morning? We all go through it. We're all human. We all go through struggles and trials and tribulations. We all have issues in life that we have to deal with, that we wake up each and every morning and we have to go through our day when we have to face those things that are ahead of us. But he says to preach deliverance to the captives. There is people all over this world that are bound, that are struggling, that are hurting. for a way out. They're looking for a way out. There's a reason why they go to the bottle. There's a reason why they go to drugs. There's a reason why they go to relationship after relationship after relationship. It's because they're looking and they're searching and they're trying to find something that will satisfy that void that is in their life. And nothing seems to do it. Nothing seems to fill that void. We were all made by him and for him. Jesus is the Savior of the world. He is the answer to everything that is going on in the world. The gospel is the good news. I want to hear some good news. I want to wake up and know that, hey, there's good news, that there is hope in this world. That it's not all doom and gloom. You could go look up at the news and find 1,000 bad news stories and stories that will absolutely break your heart and make you say, oh man, is there anything that's good in this world? Is there anything that possible? Guess what? What's impossible with man is possible with God. This world might be broken and this world might be in a place of darkness, but guess what? God came and showed his marvelous light to us. This day, say this day, the message of good news has come to the poor. The time has come when the Lord will save his people. He didn't come to this earth to beat us over the head with a 2x4 and say, yeah, you guys really messed up and you guys really did some wrong. He came to seek and save that which was lost. And we're lost without God. I don't care how long you've had the Holy Ghost, you need a refreshing day in and day out. Hallelujah. It doesn't just stop at the new birth, but you need to continue being filled with his power. I can't make it without the Holy Ghost. I try to do it on my own. I try to walk in my own ways and try to get good before I got God. And guess what, church? It does not work. It doesn't work that way. While we were sinners, while we were in darkness, God came into this world to save us, to deliver us, to set free the captive. I don't care how bound you are this morning, how chained up you are, and how bound you are up in your lifestyle and whatever is going on in your world, God can set you free today. God can deliver you. God can make you whole. God can make you free. Am I talking to any free people this morning? The Bible says, who the Son sets free is free indeed. You don't have to be bound. You don't have to be shackled and chained by the sins of this world. You don't have to be living in darkness. You can be a light. The church is the only beacon of light in this world. The Bible says the church is a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hid. If there's one thing that we have to do, and that is spread forth God's light. We have to share the gospel, the good news. Because people don't need any more bad news. They need some good news. They need something to say, hey, there's hope. It's not all bad. It's not all what it looks and seems to be, but there's some good. There's some life. There's some hope. There's some opportunities for me to make it in this world. That I don't have to struggle day in, day out. Just because you're saved doesn't mean you're always saved. We can neglect such great salvation. We could stop praying. We could go back to that old lifestyle. The gospel still works. The gospel has not changed. 2,000 years ago, the gospel, that message that they preached on the day of Pentecost, is still the message today. That has not changed. It has not wavered. There's no doubt in it. That is the message and the plan of salvation. There is going to be healing for the brokenhearted. There is going to be deliverance to the captives. There is going to be recovery of sight to the blind. you feel like you drifted away from God, God's still reaching for you. God still loves you. God still cares about you. Even if you get one thing out of this message, that God still wants you. And God still needs you. God is going to set at liberty to them that are bruised. Anybody bruised this morning? Anybody hurting this morning? Anybody struggling this morning? He came to set free those who are oppressed, downtrodden, bruised, and crushed by tragedy. We all go through hurt and pains in life. But what's the source we run to help get us through those times of difficulties? He came to preach the acceptable year of the Lord, the day when salvation and the favor of God would abound greatly. He came to set free the burdened and the battered, those that were crushed and those that were bruised and those that were left on the outside. He didn't call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. He came to those that were hurting, those that needed a way out, those that we needed a way of escape, those that were tired of living the life they were living. It's amazing when you shine light on something, darkness seems to go away. There's brighter days ahead. You don't have to feel this morning that, hey, you know what? There is no hope. There's hope in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. He can pardon your forgiveness. He can forgive you of your sins. Hallelujah. We serve a great and mighty God. He's a chain breaker. Bound this morning, he can break those chains. He can deliver you. He can set you free. That's the God that I serve. That's the God that I know. I don't know any other God than that. I know a God that loves us and cares about us, that he can show up in the middle of a Sunday morning service, and his glory could come down in this place and we can feel his presence. Jesus' ministry would be characterized by a few things. He wanted to bring restoration and freedom to societies oppressed. Those that were marginalized, those that were poor, those that were brokenhearted, those that were captive, those that were blind and bruised. As Paul says in Ephesians 2, 5 and 6, says, even when we were dead in sins, wages of sin is death, hath quickened us together with Christ. By grace ye are saved. Meaning quickened us, it means, or he has made us alive. You have a living hope this morning. You are not dead, you are alive in Christ Jesus. I was dead in the sin, but the gospel made me live again. Hallelujah. I was born and shaped in iniquity, but the gospel made me live again. Hallelujah. Verse 6 says, and he hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Are you thank God that there is heavenly places for us to sit this morning? To participate in some spiritual blessings that God has for us. You know, we got a present evil in this age. We got things coming against the church, against our families. But even with that present reality, we have a present future at the same time. We're not lost. We're not gone. We got a present future. We got a place that we call home. We got a place that we're going to. We are trying to make heaven our home. We are trying to make it. And at the same time, grab as many people as we can and bring them along with us. You're not a beggar and you're not a low man on the totem pole this morning. You might feel like there's no place for you, but God has a place prepared for you. for you. You might feel like I can't sing and I really can't do anything for the Lord, but that God still loves you. You might feel like you have nothing to offer, but God says, I don't care, I still want you. The gospel is reaching for those that are poor, those that are brokenhearted, those that are captives, those that are bound, those that are bruised and broken and blind. He's reaching for those that are without to bring them into a place with him. You know, he had 99 in his sheepfold, and that's pretty good a number. I'm like, anybody would be happy to have 99 out of 100. You got 90%, 99% working for you. You got 99% of your flock still with you. That's still a pretty good percentage. It's not in God's economy. He still is going to reach for that one. He still is going to leave that 99 and go after that one. I tell you, church, the gospel still works. Hallelujah. It's not a dead, it's alive. I don't serve a dead God. I serve a living God. I serve a God that is able to do exceedingly above anything we could ask or think. You don't serve a dead and a mimic God. You serve a God that loves you and cares about you. It was a great word last Sunday. And I feel like pastor comes up here and he just plows and you guys get filet. And then, you know, I come up here and you guys get chopped liver. But I'm thankful that I serve a God that he has a place for me. I might not be the most eloquent in my speech, but I got a God that loves me. I got a God that saves me. I got a God that reached into my world and said, hey, I got a place prepared for you. I got a place that you can call home. I got a place, hallelujah, where you can make it, that you can survive, that you can keep on going. Church, he's a chain breaker this morning. He's a deliverer. Stop sitting there like you're some low man, that you're low man on the totem pole. Our God loves you. Our God cares for you. He showed up when everything was a mess. He showed up when, hallelujah, when you were dead and you were gone. And he broke you free of those chains. Hallelujah. He liberated you. Hallelujah. He changed you in a moment. Come on, let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. I really don't, and I mean it. I know he still will care for me. I still know he will bless me because I serve a good God like that. But just the fact that he saved me was enough. You know, sometimes we get saved and we just want all the blessings. That's what we live for, God. And once we stop getting the blessings, and when the blessings stop flowing, the blessings never stop flowing. You just got your eyes somewhere else. Your sister and your brother, whatever they said to you, I'm saying they're still a blessing. But you got your eyes focused on something else. You got your eyes focused back onto the world. I'm going to tell you got to get back into your closet. You got to get back in a place where you say, God, I surrender to you, God. I need you, God. I'm going to pour my heart out to you. I'm going to pour everything that I am. I'm going to love you with all my mind, body, soul, and strength, God. Hallelujah. I'm going to give you my very best. Hallelujah. It might not be much. It might just be 2 mites, but I'm going to give you my very best. Hallelujah. I'm going to give you my all. He goes on to say in verse 6 of Ephesians, and hath raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. You know, there is a present hope. There is a present reality that we're in, but there is a future and a hope where we, hallelujah, have a place that we can call home. Hey, Sister Josephine's already there. Sister Josephine just beat us to the punch. You can't of a precious woman than Sister Josephine was. But you know what? She believed in this gospel. She held true to this gospel. She didn't waver one time. Hallelujah. And if she did, I could not see it. I was not aware of it. She was a woman of faith. Hallelujah. A woman of prayer. I can look to Sister Josephine and say, hey, she made it. I want to make it too. Hey, I'm not done yet living for God. I got more to give. You got more to give this morning. And I'm not talking about your tithes. If you want to put more in the offering plate, God bless you. God loves a cheerful giver, by the way. God blesses you to give back to the kingdom of God. Don't hold it to yourself and don't hoard it to yourself. It's not what the blessing's for. Sometimes we hold on to these things and we just kind of keep them safe and everything else. And God says, no. Did God hold anything back from you? He came to this earth as born of a virgin. And he came to this earth and wrapped himself in human flesh to die for me and you. He didn't hold anything back. He gave his very best. He gave of himself. While we didn't deserve it, while we were bound and shackled, we were slaves to sin. We were bound by the things of this world. I was no angel as a child. And I'm sure you weren't, so you might laugh, but you were the same way. I'm sure there you had your devil moments. But that devil would come out. And I don't know how my mom and my dad could stand me. I was a back talker. Yeah, tell you what. I was messing up with the one promise, and you know, obey thy father and mother. And I'm like, and your days will be long. Well, I was chipping away at my lifespan. I was eating away. I didn't know what I was doing. A lot of right now, I'm just trying to earn back the time that I lost. I'm trying to get back what the enemy stole from me. I let the devil work in me for too long. For too long. I thank God for this hope. I thank God for this gospel. I thank God that we can come to a place of refuge, a place that we can call home. You know, we are saved by the foolishness of preaching. We need to preach here in our life. Don't let anybody tell you any otherwise. You turn away from them, you ignore them, and you move on. You need a man of God in your life. He's going to set you straight. He's going to preach the gospel. He's going to preach the word of God. I don't want my ears tickled. If I'm doing wrong, I want to know that I'm doing wrong because I want to be saved. God didn't save me just so I can walk away and do my own thing. God didn't save you so you can walk away and do your own thing. God saved you and he gave you a man of God to pour into, you know what? For the work of the ministry so you can go out there and share it with somebody else. We're not meant to keep this to ourselves. This gospel's good news. People want to hear good news. If all I did was blow up your phone and I said, hey, I got an issue, I got a problem, I got this and this and this going on in my life, I guarantee you would stop answering that phone call. I guarantee you would hang up. Oh, it's Brother Lucky again. Oh, he stubbed his toe. And says thank you, and that's what I would need. I would need prayer. We can go all through life and we can make excuses and reasons why we can't live for God. How about you just live for God? How about you just pull yourself up and say, God, I'm going to live for you. Choose you this day who you will serve. As for me and my house, I will serve the Lord. loves you that much. That in the ages to come, in verse 7, he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Christ Jesus. You know what? It makes God happy to shower us with his goodness. It makes God so happy to bless you. Whether you're poor in spirit, doesn't matter what you are, God wants to bless you this morning. For by grace are ye saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God. Say it's a gift. Now, church, we got a gift. What do you do with gifts? I guarantee you on Christmas morning, you're not just letting that Christmas gift sit there all wrapped up and not wanting to open it. I know as a kid, I got on my mom and my daddy's bed. I said, it is time. It might have been 4 o'clock in the morning, but wake up. If they didn't wake up, there was other methods. And I won't keep that to myself what the other methods are. But eventually they got to wake up. I'll tell you what, if you're persistent with God and you're seeking after the Holy Ghost, he's going to fill you. You don't stop going towards God and everything. You don't stop trying to get what God has for you. God has a gift for you this morning. It's a gift. It's not of our works, lest any man should boast. It's nothing we can boast about. We were dead in sin. We had nothing to boast about. There was nothing in ourselves that was good. There's none good but God. There's nothing in me that can save myself. There was nothing in me that could say, hey, you know what? Hey, I'm going to be able to make it just on my own. I cannot make it on my own. I was a mess. I was tired. I was fed up. I was angry. Nobody in this room can save themselves. You can't say a prayer that is going to save you apart from faith and apart from God's grace. It's by God's grace that we are saved. It's by his grace. It's by his mercy. No. Grace. Grace is not a license to sin. Grace isn't a thing that you just take advantage of and say, well, I got God's grace. That's all I really need. Yeah, you need God's grace. We all need God's grace. But that's not it. We need to be saved. We need to be delivered. We need to be set free. And why open that gift just to go back to the same old lifestyle you've always been living? Why open such a precious gift and say, you know what? Yeah, that was fun and everything else, but you know what? I'm going to go do my back to my own ways. I look at Lot's wife and everything else, and she looked back. She didn't even know how good she had it. God spared her, God saved her, God pulled her out, but she couldn't help it but keep looking back. I'm sorry, when you live for God, you put your hands to the plow and you keep on plowing. There's no reason to look back. There's no reason to take a second glance. You just keep on plowing. You keep on moving along. And when the enemy tries to speak something in your ear, you just tell him to shut up. You ain't worth my time and my effort. I served you for too long. I gave you too much of my time and my effort. And I got nothing out of it. I got nothing out of it. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1 says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which also you have received and wherein ye stand, by which also ye are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you. Did you get that? By which you are saved. If you keep, there's things you got to keep. You can't just let go. In memory that I preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain. I don't want to believe in vain, church. It's possible to let go of your faith in the gospel. It's possible to lose out on salvation. reason why Paul is writing to the church of Corinth. He goes on to say in verse 8, 3, he said, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I have also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the scriptures." This is the death, the burial, and resurrection, the gospel, the good news. Yeah, he suffered and he died for you, but it's good news for us. Yeah, he paid the price. He paid our penalty, but it's good news for us. That's good news. That's the best news you could ever hear. That, hey, you know what? Your sin was going to keep you out of heaven, but God made a way. God said, hey, you know what? I'm going to. He was the lamb slain from the foundations of the world. Before he even spoke the world into existence, he said, I got a purpose and a plan. My people are going to mess up. They're going to do some dumb things. My creation, they're going to go wayward. They're going to lose their mind. They're going to go do and chase after other gods and other things, the things that I told them not to do, and they're going to do it anyways. They said, but I still got a purpose and a plan. I'm still going to go to the cross. I'm still going to die for the sins of the world. I'm still going to do this because I love him. You know, we love him because he first loved us. And there is no greater love than this than a man lay down his life for a friend. We got no greater love that we have right now than what Jesus Christ did for us on that cross. And that wasn't it, that he rose again the third day. He is the one true and a living God. He conquered death, hell, and the grave. Hallelujah. He came to this earth as a baby. He was Emmanuel, a God with us. This pastor was preaching, he's in us. A God that he lives inside us. And God that he has filled us. And God that he has saved us. This same gospel transformed Paul from a murderer and a blasphemer, hallelujah, into a soul winner. You might be doing everything ungodly under the sun, but God still loves you. His love is not in question. He loves you this morning. There's nothing you can't do to make God stop loving you. You might do some horrible things to other people, and they might stop loving you, but God's not going to stop. God's not going to shut that door on you. He's not going to close that door on you. He's going to creak that door open just enough to know that, hey, you know what? You're still welcome home. There's still a place for you to come back to. Don't let the enemy lie to you and say, hey, there's no hope. Hey, keep living the way you're living. I'm like, you're not going to make it out of this. I'm going to tell you, hallelujah, the gospel still works this morning, church. Told Nicodemus in John 3. Church, God's on the throne. He's on the throne. He is in charge, and he is going to make a way. He's going to reach you. You can reject him this morning, and he's still going to reach for you. He's still going to reach out his hand. I heard somewhere, I don't know who said it, but he said as Jesus was on the cross, he had his hand stretched out to both men. To both men. He was offering it to both of them. Only one took it. Only one took the bait. The other one rejected it. He stretched out his hand to both of you. He knew that one was going to reject him, but he still stretched his out hand towards him. He still loves you this morning. Even if you leave this place, and I pray you don't leave this place, but even if you leave this place this morning and say, God, I'm like, it's not for me, he's still going to love you. As long as you've got breath, there is hope. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto you, except ye a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Nicodemus saith unto him, How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter the second time in his mother's womb and be born? We can rationalize things in our mind and try to say, but God's ways are not our ways, and his thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are higher than our ways. And Nicodemus is trying to figure out. He comes to him in darkness. He comes to him, and guess what? It doesn't matter when you come to Jesus. I'm like, Jesus is still going to light the way to him. He's still going to make a way where you can find him, where he's accessible, where he's available, and he's just waiting on you to make that choice to say, hey, God, I want to live for you. God, I want to serve you. God, I want to know you. He's not going to close that door, but there is that day that that door will be shut. It could be today. It could be right after this service. God can show up. God is able. God is able to save you this morning. He goes on to say, Jesus answered, said, Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter into the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Marvel not that I said unto thee, ye must be born again. It wasn't a suggestion. It wasn't, hey, maybe you should think about it. No, it said, you must be born again. If you want to make heaven your home, you got to be born again of the water and Spirit. He goes on to say, the wind bloweth where it listeth, and thou hearest the sound thereof, but canst not tell whence it cometh and whither it goeth. So is every one that is born of the Spirit. It's not just a certain group. It's not just a selective group. It was everyone. Everyone that is born. That plan of salvation is for everyone. It's not for just a certain minority group that says, hey, if you do such and such, it's by the grace of God that we are saved. You know what? We've all have sinned. Nicodemus was getting an answer from the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords that, hey, you know what? This is what you need to do. This is the pathway forward. If you want to enter in the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. And in closing this morning, if Sister Jones would come, I'll take you to Acts. Acts chapter 2. Verse 1, it said, And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. See, Jesus said there was going to be a sound. And it filled all the house where they were sitting. And you could be sitting and still receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You could be in your home and still receive the Holy Ghost. It's not just bound to one location. It makes it a little bit easier to do it in church because there's the presence of God that's there. You got fellow believers that are worshiping and praising God. There's an atmosphere that is conducive for it. Just like this, you had 120 in an upper room, and the Bible says, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And they began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. The Holy Ghost, God's Spirit, filled them in this upper room. And they were dwelling in Jerusalem, Jews, devout men, out of every nation in heaven. Now, when this was noised abroad, Pastor touched on it before I came up here. And he said, noised abroad, that the multitude came together and were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. They were speaking in a language that were like, hey, there's no way that these men could be talking like this. There's no way that these men can be speaking all this type of stuff. What's going on here? They got their attention, and some of them mocked them and said, hey, they were drunk, hey, and everything else. And Peter, in verse 14, says, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said on to them, ye men of Judea and all that dwell at Jerusalem, be this known unto you and hearken to my words. For these are not drunken as ye suppose, seeing it is but the third hour of the day. Hey, you get a hold of God in the morning time. It's probably the best time to get a hold of them. By the end of your day, you're probably worn out, tired, probably won't do it. You get up in the morning, you make time for God. You bring God into your day. You bring God into your focus on your job. Because those people that you're working with need some good news. They don't need a beaten down, ran over child of God. You are a king's child. You are the reason why God placed you in that job is to be a light. The reason why God filled you with the Holy Ghost is to show forth His glory. And it shall come to pass in the last days, saith God, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. He is still pouring out His spirit today. Over 2,000 years ago, God is still pouring out His spirit on all flesh. See, that includes me. And that includes your children and your daughters. That includes every one of us. See, you can't mess up bad enough where God won't stop reaching for you. Peter goes on and he preaches the gospel. He preaches the death, burial, and resurrection. And the response in verse 37, and now when they heard this, when they heard what they had done, when they heard what God exposed, and Peter exposed what was going on in their life, and they heard this, they were pricked in their heart, they were convicted, and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Nicodemus almost had the same question. How can I be born again? How can I enter my mother's womb a second time? He said, no, thou must be born again of the water and the spirit. All Peter is doing on here in verse 38 is reemphasizing what Jesus already told Nicodemus. So Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For the promise is unto you, say to me, and to your children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. And with many words, other words, did he testify and exhort, saying, save yourselves from this untoward generation. God, it's God's grace that reaches for us. Hallelujah. If you'd stand with me this morning, these altars are open.